Okay, so good morning, everyone. Happy Friday, and welcome to our live session this morning. I would like to take this time and introduce to some, but not everyone, our speaker for today, Dr. Thomas Tobin. A lot of you guys met him last time, but for those of you who don't know him, Dr. Tobin is the Program Area Director for Distance Teaching and Learning on the Learning Design Development and Innovation Team at the University of Wisconsin-Madison, as well as an internationally recognized speaker and author on quality and technology enhanced education, especially copyright evaluation of teaching practice, academic integrity, and accessibility and universal design for learning, which is what we're here to learn about today. Dr. Tobin holds a PhD in English literature and a second master's degree in information science. He has professional certifications in project management, online teaching, quality matters, and accessibility core competencies. Some of his books include Evaluating Teaching, Online Teaching, Implementing Best Practices, and one again in which he's gonna talk to us today about, and that's Reach Everyone, Teach Everyone, Universal Design for Learning in Higher Education. So without further ado, I would like to turn this over to Dr. Tobin and welcome everyone.
Thank you very much, Dr. C.I., and it's good to be with you. Thank you very much for inviting me. As you heard, my name is Tom Tobin, and I specialize in things that scare the heck out of faculty members, things like academic integrity and cheating, things like copyright. This topic for today is one of those topics. This is one of those where you think, boy, I should have learned about this somewhere in graduate school, but nobody ever taught me. So in the next hour, I'd like to make you two promises about what we will do with regard to universal design for learning. I promise you, one, that you will leave here with practical, easy to implement things that can help save you time and effort and can help lower barriers for your students as well. And I don't know about you, but in response to COVID-19, where everybody is running around like a nut trying to figure out what do we need to do for the fall, these are going to be specific techniques that you can use to actually shortcut a lot of the work that you're going to have to do for the fall. So my promise number one is I want to save you some time and give you a way to focus your energy on your course development. Second promise. Now, with the COVID-19 happening, all of us are kind of stuck at home. We've been quarantined. We're doing social distancing. And in my house, I don't know about yours, we're watching a lot of movies again. We just got done with all the Lord of the Rings movies. We just settled in on Star Wars as well. And you're going to see in this presentation a whole bunch of probably really bad Star Wars jokes. That's just a metaphor. Even if you've never seen any of the Star Wars movies, you can still follow along, but it helps to have a little bit of a hook. And I have to admit, I'm kind of a giant nerd. So if there are any other giant nerds here among us today, please know that you're about to see some fine Star Wars documentation. I also want to say thank you to the folks at TSU Global for inviting me to come and work with all of you. That's Dr. Cheryl C.I., whom you just heard from, but also Dr. Robbie Melton, Ms. Anita McGeha, Dr. Deborah Bellamy. They're on the call here as well, monitoring the chat and making sure that it's an interactive session. Speaking of interactive sessions, this is one of them. This is not just me talking to you for an hour. So please make sure that you're doing two good things. One, you can avoid Zoom fatigue by actually turning your video off. And that helps with bandwidth. And it means that not everybody is looking at you at the same time on little tiny postage stamps worth of their video. The other thing that you can do is, please, I am interruptible during this conversation. So if you have an idea, Ken Sessions is just doing it right here in the session. He says, yay for geeks. And Dr. Tokisha Warner says, nerds rule. So this is exactly what I'm about. Have that side conversation in the chat. If you have a question for me, I'll keep an eye on the chat as well. And if I miss one, our colleagues in TSU Global will give voice to some of those things as well. We're also going to be using the live microphone. If you do want to come on and share a comment or an idea or a question, please use the raise hand feature. We'll acknowledge you and bring you into the live conversation. So you have some options for how you interact today. If you don't know where that is, if you hover your mouse over the participants tools here in Zoom, raise your hand is one of those tools. All right. So it looks like we have some votes for Star Wars documentation here in the chat too. So let's actually get started with part of that Star Wars theme. Wendy says, that's ominous. Yep. Does anybody recognize the music? Excellent. Shiloh says, Imperial March. Wendy says, that's Darth Vader's theme. John says, Imperial March. Yep, absolutely. And here's a little bit of Star Wars trivia for you complete nerds out there. All the people who are saying either the Emperor's theme, Darth Vader's theme, or the Imperial March, you're both correct. John Williams, the person who wrote the score for the Star Wars movies, actually used this theme both in Darth Vader's theme music, and he used it in the overture to the entire movie. So there's two different titles here. There's also another thing here. You'll notice on the screen it says music playing, and you could have just looked. It says the Star Wars Emperor's theme is playing. That's one of the ways that you can be really helpful to your students. If you have audio or video content, you can give them more than one way to understand what's going on. And this isn't a way to dumb down our content. It's just a way to give people more access to it. Here's a quick question for you folks, and if you'd like to come on to the live microphone, please put a hand up, or if you'd like to respond in the chat, I'll take a couple of seconds and just ask an open question. Why might we be starting a session on accessibility and universal design and inclusive design with the bad guy's theme music from the Star Wars movies? Any ideas, any thoughts on that? I'll wait a couple of seconds. And Dr. Tokisha says, building suspense. Margaret says, it seems daunting. Wendy says, it's scary, meaning UDL can be scary as well. Yeah, this is good feedback so far. So far, I don't see anybody with a raised hand to come onto the microphone. Gabriel says, we're facing an opponent. Ooh, let's talk a little bit about that adversarial mindset, because that's something that I want to cover when we're talking today. So excellent. Mike says, because UDL may be seen as the establishment. Yeah, this is part of the challenge, is that we have policies in place for how we all should interact with our students. I'd actually like to say that Universal Design for Learning is a way for us to side a little bit more on the rebel side of the house than the empire side of the house, if you understand the metaphor. But you don't have to go along with the Star Wars metaphor to go where we're going here. Let's take a couple of seconds, and I'd like to just take the temperature in the room. There's about 60 of us together here today. Take a minute and either key into the chat or put a hand up and we'll bring you onto the live microphone. But what is one thing that you already know about Universal Design for Learning? On your screen, you see an image from one of the Star Wars movies. On the left is the bad guy. He has the red laser sword. And on the right is the good guy with the blue one. And they're about to face off and do battle on a desert planet that's all salt. But what's one thing that you already know about Universal Design for Learning? And this could be as simple as, I've heard the term before, all the way to, I teach this in my graduate courses, and give me the mic. pause here for a second. Let some of these ideas come in here. Dean Malloy is saying, when UDL is done correctly, you don't know it's there. It just seems like part of the regular environment. Ooh, I like that phrasing. Dr. Warner says it's less about disability and more about inclusivity for multiple learning styles. That is true, and I want to do some myth busting in a minute. From Wendy, it requires a lot of work. That is true, and I want to do a little myth busting in a minute, so hang on to those. B. Kilborn says you need to vary the format of content. That is also true, and it's one part of universal design for learning. And we'll talk about why that's so. Mary Shelton talks about explanatory captions for photos. Yep. Christine says it opens up learning to more people. That is correct. Lori says strategies for making learning accessible and inclusive. That is the overall goal of universal design for learning. We've got some good starts here and some good strategies. And I want to check and see if anybody has a hand up here. So far, I don't see folks putting a hand up to come onto the microphone. That's entirely all right. You've got the choice. And John Berger has put a link into our chat to the UDL guidelines at CAST, the Center for Accessible Special Technology in Boston. These are actually the neuroscientists who came up with the idea of universal design for learning. And we're going to talk briefly about how their work informs what we do in higher education. So this is a wonderful baseline of knowledge about universal design for learning. And you heard me say a couple of times that I wanted to do some myth busting. Here's the myth busting. One of the comments was universal design for learning requires a lot of work. That is true and not true. And I'll explain what I mean. Universal design for learning is not actually a set of specific practices. It's not you put the captions on your videos and you put time estimates on things and you do this, 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 and this, and you check this box for all these 10 things and then you've done universal design for learning. UDL is more of a mindset. It's more of a framework that helps us to think through the interactions that we have with our learners so that they are more inclusive, so that people can have broader access to them. Is that a lot of work? Overall, yes. But in the individual instance, it's actually one little change at a time. And all the things that we're going to talk about in this hour are about those little changes that you can make that have a big positive impact. So I'd like to help you to focus your ideas and your approach. Now, there's one more myth busting that we have to do here. There was another comment to talk about inclusivity for multiple learning styles. Now, you folks have heard about learning styles, right? We have visual learners, auditory learners, kinesthetic learners who learn by moving their bodies and doing. I'm going to say something controversial that is actually backed up with 45 years of neuroscience data. And I'm going to say it quietly, and then you can respond in the chat. Here it is. Learning styles don't exist. Let that sink in for a second here. Learning styles don't exist. The idea of being a visual learner or auditory learner is that that's your primary mode by which you learn best. And the learning styles theory has been debunked many, many times. And I'd encourage you, if you like, to go check out Michelle Miller from Northern Arizona University. She's one of the neuroscientists who's been doing this work. And she talks eloquently about why learning styles, the idea of a learning style as a fixed characteristic of us, is baloney. So if I'm supposedly a visual learner and you give me an audio file to listen to, does that mean that I cannot learn from that audio file? No. Does that mean that I will always prefer to look at or see visual information? Also, no. And John is posting something in the chat here that is perceptive. He says learners have preferences and have the ability to flex to other means of receiving information. That's exactly right. Learning styles, fixed characteristics that we have to cater to, they don't exist. Learning preferences do, and they change from moment to moment. They're based on either our preferences in the moment or sometimes the circumstances that dictate how we can get access to things. I'll give you an example, and then let's dive right in. An example is, imagine a single father who works in a particular city, but has to drive 40 minutes to drop his daughter off at school in the morning and then drive back in order to get to work. That drive time is time that he can't use for studying. But if he was able to take the journal articles that you're asking him to read as one of your students, and he could have that journal article read out loud through the speakers in his car or through his mobile phone, he's just found more time for studying than he had before. And it can be the 20 minutes that we give people options and choices that can be the difference between struggling and keeping up. So thank you for letting me do a little bit of myth busting here.
I have placed information vital to the survival of the rebellion into the memory systems of this R2 unit.
And what you just heard was Carrie Fisher, the actress who passed away a couple of years ago. She played Princess Leia in the Star Wars movies. And on your screen, there she is, the galactic princess. And the bad guys are about to board her ship. And she has the plans for the bad guy's secret weapon. That's the audio that you just heard. And she's putting the information into R2-D2, one of the robot companions in the saga of Star Wars. And she's hoping that information goes to Obi-Wan Kenobi, the wise old sage who's going to help the rebellion. Well, in the George Lucas cinematic universe, they call those robots droids. And I'm really grateful that Motorola has created a phone called a droid. I'm actually using one today. And it's the same principle. Back in the 1970s, when the Star Wars movies first came out, the princess had to take what looked suspiciously like a compact disc and stick it into the robot and then hope that the robot would get to the right place. Our way of sharing information these days is much simpler, but we're still using our mobile devices. Most of our students, and I've got the data for the counties around Tennessee State, I think it's something like 89% of adults in those counties in Tennessee own a smartphone. And the percentage goes up as you get younger and younger. So if we're talking about our traditional 18 to 22-year-old freshmen, they have their smartphones in much greater numbers, but also our adult learners have them as well. So if we can reach out to our students in ways that they can do things with their mobile devices, then we're going to give them greater options. We're going to give them more time for study. Now, on your screen is Liam Neeson in one of the Star Wars movies that everyone would prefer to forget, I think. It's one of the odd-numbered ones. But he's got a communicator. He's playing Qui-Gon Jinn, and he's trying to use his two-way communicator to talk to his comrades who are back on their spaceship. Now, here's a little bit of trivia for you Star Wars nerds out there. I'll take this in the chat, or if you actually know the answer, just come on the microphone and say. But Liam Neeson, the actor, is holding that communicator device. Does anybody know what that communicator device actually is? It's a real-world 21st century object that's just been painted a different color, and it's got some little plastic bits glued onto it. Anybody know what it is?
Is it a StarTAC phone?
That is an excellent guess, and that was Wendy talking, correct?
Yes.
Awesome. It is not actually a mobile phone, and Mike is saying it's somebody's mobile phone. It's much more prosaic. It's much simpler than that. I won't keep you in suspense.
Is it a walkie-talkie?
Dr. Warner, good question. It's not a walkie-talkie. It's actually not a piece of electronic technology at all. Lori has a guess that it's a remote control.
A stopwatch?
No. And here, let me tell you what it is.
It's a pager.
No, it's not. And Margaret says it's a box cutter. Let me tell you what it is. And you people who are ladies and you people who are swimmers will know what this is. This is a Venus women's shaving razor with the blade head removed. It's got a wide handle, so for better grip. It's just a piece of plastic. They took the blades off the shaving razor and then painted it a different color and put a bunch of little gewgaws on it to make it look all spacey and futuristic. Why am I bothering to tell you about this weird technology thing? And I see a lot of lols and that is hystericals in the chat. Because it can feel like this is how professors are trying to communicate with students. Students can see us as instructors or us as support staffers, and it can be like we're talking into our razors rather than our phones. So as a thought experiment, what's one way that we could talk to our students or give our students information beyond just the learning management system and beyond email? What's a way that we could reach out to them that they could get information on the devices that they already have, their mobile phones? So take a couple of seconds, key one thing into the chat, or if you like, just come onto the live microphone and share an idea. If you want to be all Star Wars-y about it, you could say, how else could Keegan communicate with his friends? But you don't have to follow along with the Star Wars. Let's just talk about our students. Let's see. Mike says, post videos on a YouTube channel, 1 to 3 minute videos. Dee Malloy says, Web 2.0 solutions. Can you say more about Web 2.0 there? And Joshua says, do an audio podcast. Yeah, you can actually, you can do that on your phone and then host it somewhere. Splendid ideas so far. And I'm curious about that Web 2.0 solutions. Can you name one of them or specify for us? Ah, here we go. So YouTube, blogs, things like that. Excellent. And Dr. Warner saying 3D videos. You know, I'm seeing on places like Facebook and Twitter and other social media channels that there are now the options to do 3D presentations. Dee Malloy saying things like Prezi. So you'll notice that almost all of these solutions that people are suggesting are technological solutions, but they're also ones that have very low barriers to entry. Almost all of us can use the technology that's in our pockets in order to do a quick video, a 30-second introduction to a topic for our course, those kinds of things. And I'd like to show you how to make that into UDL as a practice. So excellent ideas.
It's true.
And you just heard Han Solo, in my opinion, the real hero of the Star Wars movies, but we can have that conversation later, talking to some of the new heroes on your screen. There's all the heroes standing in a spaceship, and the hero of the older movies is talking to Finn and Rey, the heroes of the new series of movies. And he's saying that he thought that the Force, that part of the Star Wars universe that pushes things toward a predestined conclusion, he's saying that he thought it was all bunk, until he saw it actually in action. If you're thinking about religious studies here, he's your Thomas character, the doubting character who had to actually see it to believe it. On your screen are also the words Universal Design for Learning. And one of our colleagues put the link to the Universal Design for Learning guidelines from CAST, the Center for Applied Special Technology in Boston. This is the official definition. On your screen, you see three phrases. And what's missing is the phrase multiple means of. And this is what makes UDL powerful. Giving students choices, multiple ways for them to stay engaged. Giving information in multiple ways. And then giving people choices about how they take action or express their learning in multiple ways. Now, does that mean that we have to try to create every single possible variation of our lecture notes? No. In fact, that would burn us out. What I'd like to suggest is that instead of these three core elements of UDL, when you go talk to your colleagues back at your faculty meetings or your staff gatherings, don't tell them this. Tell them instead, and your screen changes now, that universal designing is really just plus one thinking. What I mean by plus one if there's one way for students to interact now with our materials, which is where everybody starts, but if there's one way for them to interact with one another, one way for them to interact with you as the instructor or a support staffer, and one way for them to interact with the wider world as part of the interactions in your course or how you interact with students, if there's one way for that stuff to happen now, make one more way. That's it. You don't have to try to anticipate every single possibility. In fact, that would drive us a little batty. What I'd like to suggest is by taking action to give people plus one choices, you make it easier on your students, you make it easier on yourself, and instead of it being a lot of work, it's work that actually pays you back later. Your students will have fewer questions about the material. They won't ask you the same question 8 million times. Your students are less likely to everyone get the same thing wrong on a test or a quiz and you end up having to reteach. Your students are less likely to say, oh yeah, hey professor, that was great, but I still don't get it. And then you end up trying to figure out a different way to say something. In fact, it's those pinch points, those pain points that you probably already know. Those are the good places to start doing some plus one thinking. And I'd like to suggest that when you're in that faculty meeting and somebody says, oh yeah, that's just, isn't that for people with disability barriers in their lives? That you come back and you say, no, actually, Universal Design for Learning is thinking about those interactions for everybody in the class. Because if you're thinking about UDL and you're only thinking about accessibility, if you're only thinking about learners with disabilities, that's an easy mental mistake to make. But you all in this session, you know better now. You know that our students are trying to get access to their learning environments through their mobile devices. Lots of them don't even have a computer or a laptop at home. And with COVID, they can't just go to Starbucks or go to McDonald's and grab free Wi-Fi very easily. So if you're reframing things for mobile device learners, that has an impact on everybody. That's work that actually has a positive effect for all of your learners. On your screen, there's a couple, a man and a woman who won a contest to go down to Disney and actually interact with the costumed characters. Here, the woman of the prize-winning couple has picked up a lightsaber and she's doing battle with Darth Vader, the bad guy, and one of the stormtroopers is there. And the guy who won the prize, he's looking at his phone. But this is something that we can, as educators, take advantage of. Am I suggesting that you create a fully mobile version of your course? No. Am I suggesting that your students are likely to be using their mobile devices at least a bit, and some of them a lot, in order to interact with us? Yes. So if we think about them and the time when they're on their mobile devices, then it helps us think about how we design those interactions. And that was the sound of Darth Vader, the bad guy's spaceship, rumbling through space, coming toward us. The problem is that space is a vacuum and the spaceship shouldn't make any sound and it shouldn't carry across space. So every time you see a space movie and you see the starship moving through space and you hear that rumbling sound, you will know that that is totally not going to happen if it were actually out there in space. Okay, let's go away from the trivia and take a pause for a moment. On your screen are two young men. On the left is Luke Armstrong. Yes, his parents named him Luke for a reason. Those of you who know the Star Wars movies, that's the name of the hero. He's a young man who gets around in a wheelchair. Here he is in his wheelchair. He's dressed up as Darth Vader, the bad guy. He and his parents fashioned some panels to stick on the side of his wheelchair, so it looks like Darth Vader's personal spaceship. And his parents are dressed up like the Imperial Guards who guard Darth Vader. They won the costume contest at Disney that year. Also on your screen is Ryan Miller. He's a young man in Colorado. He gets around with a wheelchair as well. He and his father spent the summer a couple of years back building a snow speeder costume for him, and he's dressed up like the hero of the Star Wars movies, Luke Skywalker. He went around his neighborhood in Colorado and he collected 800 pounds of Halloween candy with this costume. And then he turned around and sold it and he donated the money to charity. I will never be as good as this kid on your screen. But these kids on your screen are actually something that gets in the way of most of your colleagues adopting inclusive design techniques of any kind, because they're going to say to you, well, it's all that work and it's only for just a few people, like the students with disabilities, the students in wheelchairs or with canes to get around, or people with service animals, or people who have hearing impairments. And they'll say, you know, it's all that work. I'm just going to wait until I get the piece of paper from the disability services office that says give them time and a half on the test or some other accommodation. And when you respond to them, you can respond this
way. Use the comm link. Oh my, I forgot, I turned it off.
On your screen is Luke Skywalker, the hero. He's on his communicator talking to C-3PO, one of the robots who's in a control room somewhere in the building. He and his friends are in danger because they've managed to land down a garbage chute and the walls are closing in to squash them. And he's trying to get the robots to turn off this garbage compactor. And on your screen, it says UDL is access, no matter why. I've actually stopped talking about accessibility when I make an argument for inclusive design, and I talk only now about access. Because when you talk to your colleagues and you say accessibility, they can think, oh yeah, people with disabilities, accommodations, making one change one time for one person. What we're about, and we're going to get into this in a minute now, what we're about is making changes ahead of time, before the class even starts, that make doing those accommodations, doing those special one-time requests, much less necessary. And that's my promise to you. I wanted to give you some things that can save you some effort, save you some work, so that when you do make intentional changes or additions, then you're actually helping yourself out. And Professor Mageha is saying proactive and not retrofitting. I'd argue that you can do both. Being proactive, if you are designing an interaction from scratch, it is much less work to design it in an inclusive fashion and save yourself time. But if you do have to retrofit, if you are going back to an existing course, here are some things that you can do. So on your screen now is a quotation from Sam Johnston. She is one of those neuroscientists at CAST, and I spoke to her a couple of years ago. In that conversation, she said something that made me stop. And I'm actually going to break a presenter's rule, and I'm going to read what's on the screen to you because it's that important. She said, we want a situation that is good for everybody, and that's thinking about what has to happen at the level of design that makes accommodation less necessary. Accommodations, they can make us a little mad, right? I thought I had all of my prep work done for this semester, and then in the second week, a student comes and has the paperwork from the disability services office, and now I have to do all this work just to support one student. So the more we can identify where those challenge points are for everybody, fewer of those students will come to us with that accommodation paperwork. We'll never get rid of it entirely, but that's not the point of Universal Design for Learning. The point is to lower barriers for access for everybody so that more people feel a part of rather than apart from. So let me get to my promise. On your screen is a hand glowing with light behind it. And that stands for the 5 strategies that I'd like to suggest you can use tomorrow. And don't take my word for it. Try some of these things out. See how they work for you. Adapt them. Find out what other people are doing. Have that community conversation. So here we go. Strategy 1, start with text. A lot of the suggestions that we had for how can Qui-Gon help reach out to all of his colleagues, they were things like posting videos on a YouTube channel, some of those Web 2.0 solutions like blogs or audio podcasts, doing videos, Prezi, somebody put PowTunes that we didn't catch earlier here. Megan said post files or video formats that display within the Pulse app for the eLearn or D2L system. almost all of those are excellent suggestions that require students to be able to take in that information in just one way, by listening to your podcast or watching your video. Now, give them one more way by starting with text. So if you have lecture notes, or if you're going to create a 30-second introduction to a particular unit in your class, or there's a hard concept that students always have questions about and you want to make a study guide, start out by creating some text to go with it, to stand for it. And if you have text and then you read off from that text to do your video or your audio, then you automatically have your plus one alternative, and students can choose, do they read the text? Do they watch the video? And they can make those choices in the moment based on their preferences or the circumstances that dictate that they can or can't do something. Maybe a student is in a library or on a bus or somewhere where they can't have audio on, or one of your students has put their kids to bed and they don't have headphones to plug in, but they still want to watch your introductory video or your explainer video. Then maybe they go to the text alternative. So the first one is, if you start with text, you automatically have a plus one. By the way, if you're like me and you don't want to start with text and you just want to talk to the camera or do your multimedia, that's fine. Just make sure you do the text on the back side of that. So strategy one was start with text. Strategy two is make alternatives. On your screen, there's a chemistry professor in her lab, and she's seated at a bench where there's a computer. On her computer screen is a PDF of a journal article that she'd like her students to work on. There's also two students in the chemistry lab with the professor. One student is turning his head toward us and giving us a thumbs up because he knows that we can take that PDF, and if it's not just a scan of a book page, but it's actually a born digital PDF, like you created a Microsoft Word document and did save as PDF, then students can download that PDF and they can have screen readers or audio readers read that stuff out loud. And read aloud programs are not just for people with visual challenges. For that single dad who had to drop his daughter off at school, one of those read out loud apps would be wonderful. And there's a bunch of free ones on the Google Play Store or the Apple iTunes Store for everybody's mobile devices. There's a second student in the chemistry lab. He has a big professional video camera over his shoulder, and he's taking video of the professor explaining a concept. Behind this student, there's an image of a still camera, because this student also knows that if we take the professor's video, take five or six still images out of that video, and then for each of those still images, we put it into a word processing file and then give notes about what the important points are, that becomes a study guide. And that becomes an alternative to watching the video. People can get the same information from the text-based and still image-based guide and from the video. Now, somebody somewhere is thinking, isn't that dumbing things down? Isn't that hand-holding for the students? It is, if you're doing it poorly. It's not if you are focusing on the main takeaways and you're focusing on giving the same kind of information, keeping the rigor of your content high, but lowering the barrier for getting access to it in the first place. So UDL is not about dumbing things down. In fact, you should keep the level of challenge for all of your students at a high level. And Dee Malloy says, Dr. CI has helped us by using a company that produces closed captions, transcriptions, and make video content searchable via text. This helps with study guide creation too. Thanks, Dr. CI. Excellent, and thank you for the plug on that. So I appreciate knowing that those alternatives are there, and it's wonderful to know that you don't have to do this by yourself. Your folks at TSU Global can assist you, and we'll actually make that point and underline it right toward the end of our conversation. So thank you for bringing that into the conversation. Okay, strategy one, start with text. Strategy two, make some alternatives. Three out of the five is let them do it their way. On your screen are three different images. One is a traditional five-page paper. There's an equals sign, and then there's a bunch of audio podcast files on a screen, and another equal sign, and there's a student who has a microphone and has handed her phone to a colleague so that she can record a news reporter version of a particular activity or assignment. Here's the secret to giving students choices about how they demonstrate their skills and take action. And this, by the way, is the most powerful part of UDL, and almost none of us are doing it yet. If I can grade or give feedback on the activity the same way, regardless of the format that the students are turning it in, that's UDL. So in this case, my plus one might be you have the option to write the 3-page essay or give me the same kind of information in an audio podcast version. Students can choose whether they do a word processed version or the audio version, but you're still holding them to the same learning objectives and you're using the same criteria to grade it. Do they have a detailed thesis? Are they using details, evidence, and examples to support those things? Can they point to where they found those arguments? Can they support their experiment with data? All those things we can ask them to do, and they can show it to us in more than one way, in a plus one fashion. Now, there's an asterisk for this one. Let them do it their way. Does that mean we have to give students options on every single thing they do? No. And as a matter of fact, I teach English composition courses. So in English composition courses, one of the things I want to know is, can my students do APA formatting on a word processed file? Would a video response be able to show me how my students have done 1-inch margins and Times New Roman 12-point font double spaced? No. So if the format is the assignment, if what you're grading on is actually part of the format, then okay, don't give your students choices. The end result has to be a word processed file in that case. But then think about, where are the places where you can give students options for how they take actions? So when my students in my English composition course are composing paragraphs and I want to know that they have a thesis statement and are supporting it with evidence and examples, I let them do that in audio or in word processing format, all the while knowing and telling them so that the end result is going to have to be a word process thing. And that gives them more choice, more agency. It helps them to stick with us better. So that's 3 out of 5. Start with text. Make alternatives. Let them do it their way. The next one is strategy 4. Go step by step. I imagine there's a bunch of you out there who took driver's education either from school or from a professional company. Some of you learned to drive probably from a parent or a cousin or a family friend, maybe. But where did they tell you to put your hands on the steering wheel for maximum control of the car? Shiloh says 10 and 2. Was it 10 and 2 for everybody? Yeah. So if you imagine that the steering wheel is the face of a clock, up at 10 o'clock and 2 o'clock, you put your hands there and you can move the car around most easily. They actually don't tell our 15 and 16 year old driver's education students 10 and 2 anymore. What do they tell them? It's 9 and 3 on the sides of the wheel, right? Megan's got it right here. Why that change? Airbags. If the airbag deploys and you have your hands near the top of the wheel, it'll cross your wrists and they'll whack you in the forehead and give yourself a concussion and maybe break your wrists. If you have your hands at the side of the wheel and the airbag has to deploy, it pushes your arms away from your body. Maybe you get a little bruise on your shoulder. So there's a public safety tip from me. Awesome, and go drive safely. And John says, my uncle said, drape your left hand over the top and you can use the right hand to shift. Now, John grew up in New Jersey, so we're going to discount that driver's manual thing. There's also the one hand over and one hand out the window version of driving too. But think about 9 and 3 and 10 and 2. 10 and 2 is no longer what they tell people is a safe way to drive, but 10 and 2 is an excellent way to think about the pace of your course and your lessons. 10 is 10 minutes. That means give people information for about 10 minutes. And then 2 is 2 minutes. After that 10 minutes, ask them to take an action for 2 minutes. And here's the neuroscience secret behind this part of UDL. It doesn't actually matter whether the 2 minutes has anything to do with the 10 minutes. You could be talking about Renaissance painting or cell biology or business practices and tax law for 10 minutes. And then for 2 minutes, you could ask your students to just take a mental break, check their email for 2 minutes, go get a snack in the fridge for 2 minutes, and then come back. By the way, don't tell them check their email for 2 minutes. They actually won't come back. But the 2 minutes, it's the act of taking a break that actually helps us cement things in our brains. So on your screen, you see a possible sequence of 10 and 2. Watch a video for a few minutes, read a case study, then for 2 minutes, post your response about the case study, or even just write it down on a piece of paper. You don't have to turn in everything. That's the 2 minutes. Then another 10, read a scholarly article, watch a video, and then a 2, go out on the internet and find an example, do a scavenger hunt, and so on and so on. The worst thing that you can do is to lecture at people for 60 minutes. And you'll notice that we've been doing 10 and 2 in this session as well. We've paused for interaction. Even when we've done a deep dive, there've been times when I've said, hey, let's just stop for a minute and think and do. And Dee Malloy says, I like this strategy. John Tiller says, this is a TV production format, 10 minutes of the show and 2 minutes of commercials. And that's actually a really good metaphor for thinking about it. But instead of commercial messages, instead of taking in information for the 2 minutes, have them do something for the 2 minutes. And if you take your brain out of taking in information and put it into processing something, even if the something is different, you end up processing better on the content that you've got there. And I hear somebody on the mic. Did somebody want to come on and have conversation? Nope, looks like somebody just unmuted themselves accidentally. No worries. Last of the five, strategy 1, start with text. Strategy 2, make some alternatives. Strategy 3, where you can, let them do it their way. Strategy 4 is break things up and go step by step. And strategy 5 is set content free. This is the last one here. And Deborah says, unless it's Lifetime Movie Network and the commercials are 10-minute infomercials. Yeah, don't let your 2 get too long and don't let your 10 get too long. And what I mean here in the fifth strategy, that's actually a good segue into this fifth strategy. Set your content free in 2 different ways. One of them is use eLearn, the D2L environment, or use other places to set your content free from the clock. On your screen, there's a clock face and it has a big red X through it. The more that you can give your students access to interactions outside of the time when you are there with them in real time, the more time they're going to have for study, review, and conversation. So if you're able to put your examples, your materials, recordings of the conversations that you have with your students, so that those students who couldn't be there in real time can still benefit from them, if you can put those into the learning management system or post them in another place where students can get access, you're giving them more time for study. I also mean set content free in a different sense. Set it free from format requirements. And you math professors, I'm looking at you, but this is really true for all of us. Many of our math professors use specialized software like Stata and R for visualization of statistics. And if you post your examples into eLearn in those specialized formats, that means that your students have to have a device that has that software on it in order to see your examples. And there's no version of a lot of our specialized software for people's mobile phones. So take a screen recording software or an audio recording software, Screencast-O-Matic, Jing, Audacity. You see a bunch of them on your screen, VoiceThread. I'm not here to sell any of these, and there's lots more than are on your screen. But take a screen recording software and walk your way through using the specialized software. Show an example and narrate it for your students, and then post that video up onto your YouTube channel or into your learning management system. That way, the only thing people need in order to experience that example is a video player, and everybody's got one of those on their desktops, laptops, and their mobile phones. So let's wrap it up real quick. Those were the 5 things. Start with text, make alternatives, let them do it their way, go step by step, and set content free from the clock and from format requirements. You'll notice that you don't have to do all of these all at once, all over the place in your courses. Start with the places where things already don't go as you planned them on a regular basis. So where in your course do students always ask you the same question 700 times? Where do your students get things wrong on the quizzes and tests and you end up having to reteach? Where is a pinch point where you teach something and then the students all come back to you and say, "That was awesome, professor, and I still don't get it. Can you say it in a different way?" Those are the places to start doing plus one thinking and design. And I was really grateful that Professor C.I. and a couple of other people mentioned that you don't have to do all of this work by yourself. Your folks at the TSU Global Area, your Teaching and Learning Center, your media services, the IT area. I always advocate, on your screen is an image of a woman with a video camera up to her eye. And the text says, don't train just the faculty in inclusive design. When you go back into your faculty meetings, when you go back into your staff meetings, spread the word about universal design for learning so that when a faculty colleague calls up the folks in the media services area and says, "Hey, I want to do lecture capture," that they help out and they say, "Oh yeah, once we have those videos, we'll help you chunk them down into 4 and 5 minute segments. And we'll help you with the captions because that's just how we do here at Tennessee State." And you'd be surprised how many of your colleagues won't balk at that. They won't say, "Ooh, academic freedom, how dare you tell me how to teach," because they're getting the support that they need. And it's not a mandate from above. It's not here's a law you have to follow. It's a framework. It's a way of thinking. It's a mental guideline that helps us to understand things. So here, closer to the end of our conversation, I want to share one quick story with you, and then I want to hear what your thinking is. On your screen, there's an image of a parking lot at a grocery store. I took this picture back a few years ago when I lived in Chicago. There's snow on the ground. It's cold. It's February. And I want to say that the need to make changes is not always this obvious. My partner and I were going into the grocery store. She continued on in, but I stopped and I took this picture. And I usually am in the habit of describing what's on the screen. That's a good UDL thing to do. But in this case, I want to ask, what's wrong with this picture? If you like, put your idea in the chat or just come on the microphone. And we've got a couple of guesses coming in. We'll wait for a few people to weigh in. What's wrong with this picture? All right, we've got a few things coming in from people here. And I think everybody's got it correct. That the cart corral, or if for those of you from further point south, the buggy corral, is actually in the accessible parking space, so no one can park there. And someone said, "That's a heck of an ADA violation." Yeah. And so that cart corral is in the wrong spot, and someone who needs that parking spot can't actually use it. So I did what I thought was a good idea, right? So I went on to my phone, I got on Twitter, and I said, "Dear at name of grocery store," right? "This is at Thomas J. Tobin. I'm at your River Forest, Illinois location." And then I went to all caps and I went, "Not cool," attached the photo, and I clicked send. Now, 5 minutes later, my phone buzzed in my pocket. It was a tweet from corporate. And they said, "Indeed, at Thomas J. Tobin, not cool. We're calling the store manager right now to fix this." And I did a little dance right there in the aisle. I was like picking up my bananas and oranges. And I had done something good for my fellow human beings. In fact, the next thing on your screen, I took this photograph. When we came out, there was somebody parked there. And before you say, "Where's the little wheelchair symbol on the license plate?" In Illinois, we used hang tags. I looked, they had a hang tag. They were parked there. It was great. But my joy was short-lived because they had just moved the cart return over into the stripy part of the pavement so that this person couldn't fully open their door or get a wheelchair or other device in and out. So what's my point? My point is, aim for progress and not for perfection. If you're trying to do all the things in the next month, you're going to burn yourself out. You're not going to be able to achieve what you want. But if you identify where things aren't going well for you or places where you want things to go more smoothly, focus there first. And then next semester, come back and look at other things and look at other things and make it an iterative process. Focus on progress rather than on perfection.
No more training do you require. Already know you. That which you need.
So now that you have Yoda's blessing, the wise old counselor, I'd like to ask, what's one thing that you will take away from our time here today? Do you still have a question that we can answer? Is there something that you're doing now in an intentional way and we've underlined it as important? Is there something you want to try? Is there something that you remember? What's one thing? I love that the motto at Tennessee State University is think, work, serve. So what's the one thing that will help you to think and work and serve? Put it in the chat, raise a hand, we'll bring you onto the microphone. So Dee Malloy says plus one. Deborah Burris Kitchen says 10 and two. Salah Azad also says 10 and two. What's your one thing? What's one thing you're going to take away? Or if you still have a question, now is the time to ask. Christine Hamilton says, keep trying. Yeah, settle for small wins and take it one piece at a time. Mulugeta Wayu says, plus one. Let's see. Courtney says, I'll allow students to choose how to complete an assignment. Gabriel, the mobile device does not have to be the opponent of learning. And Mike says, take things step by step as you develop material. Test and refine. Absolutely. Don't take my word on any of this stuff. Do your reading, do your research. Kenneth says, aim for progress over perfection. Dr. Jenkins says, set content free of format requirements and the clock. Vandy says, be proactive. Dr. Takesha says, 10 and 2 interactions outside of class. Joshua says, start with text. B. Kilborn, multiple choices for assessment. Emily says, give format options. Takesha says, set content free. We've got more votes for 10 and 2 and for setting content free and for aim for progress and not for perfection. By the way, one last neuroscience thing, and then I'm going to hand it back over to our hosts. We tend to remember the ends of experiences much better than we remember the beginnings, which is why I have backloaded everything, that the last example of the cart return in the parking lot, I want you to remember that one. And then you'll say, oh, there were some other things, and you can come back and look later at the recording. But thank you, everybody. These are wonderful takeaways. It was wonderful to spend some time with all of you. And you know I'm a big Star Wars nerd, so I have to end with this. May the Force be with you. And now it's time to turn it back over to our host. Thank you all very much. This was a wonderful hour with you.
And thank you, Dr. Tobin. I did see that there was one person that had their hand raised. Dr. Tiller, did you want to unmute your mic and ask your question? Or are you
yes, please, set? Come on.
It wasn't a question. It was thank you for the confirmation about the learning styles. I did research 20 years ago in a corporate environment when the craziness of learning styles still persisted in the air. And out of that, I found, you know, no significant differences and things like that. But the bottom line metaphor for me has been the Southern hospitality of, I use the metaphor of set the learning table as rich and varied as you would your dinner table if you were inviting guests into your home. The last thing any Southern hospitality hostess would want is a person sitting with an empty plate. So that's you have confirmed all of that and brought it back in my Southern ways. Thank you.
Well, and thank you, Professor Tiller, for doing the research and giving a real example of how learning styles is not a fixed characteristic, but that we do have preferences. And so thank you very, very much. Dr. Cheryl, would you close us out, please?
Yes, I would. And I would just like to say thank you to everyone for joining us today. Dr. Melton was on earlier, but I know that she had to jump off and go to another session. So again, on behalf of TSU Global Online and the whole Smart Technology Innovation Center, we greatly appreciate your attendance. Yes, I will be posting a video of the recording soon. And I greatly appreciate you all's patience as I get these videos posted, but I will be sending out an email for that. And we want you all to have a very safe and happy weekend. And thank you very much. Okay, I'm gonna stop the recording.